We went on a road trip. Started in Colorado. And we put our fate in the hands of the audience, participants, and wound up in a whole bunch of cool places with a whole bunch of really interesting people. That's basically what we made our movie about. Superficial could also lead to like real meaning, and I think like you know that's true about our trip too. Is you start off with the it's hard to get things going, you know. So like the first day we didn't know how the project was going to start, and we just happened to be picked up by a woman who had real depth. But conversations, I mean, just in general, like to get to the depth, you need quiet. Right, the depth comes from the quieter stuff. So you got to get through a lot of the mumbo jumbo before it can be quiet. I mean, how often are you like in a room with a person in an intimate setting where it's just quiet, nobody's talking? And I think it's true of most of our projects. Is just like the first, the initial like jump off starting the project was difficult. So when Nastja's talking about us traveling around in a circle in Boulder. I don't think people really knew what the rules were because there were no rules and we were sort of making them on the fly. We have a, you know, it's sort of like, you know, bowling. You got borders up and we create these buffers, like bumpers on the sides of the project, on the periphery, but you don't really know how it's going to go until you get it going. So she was a big part of Heather was a big part of building the project with us and everyone after as well. When you first hear anywhere, you don't really know what a person's talking about. You know, anywhere, you know, doesn't necessarily mean anywhere to the first person. Because they're trying also, you know, like people taking pictures with you. You don't know where to put your arm on a person's back and you don't really want to infringe on anybody's personal space. So it's a negotiation. And I think the word anywhere was something to negotiate on. So for the first 2 days, people didn't really... know how to define anywhere. So we were working on that definition for the first 2 days, and when anywhere became anywhere, then we started moving around.
Once we picked them up, we added them to this Facebook group, and this group, you know, started one, two people, and it grew to now there's like 70 people in there, and they became a real community that are still chatting away to each other and meeting up with each other on a daily basis. And so you can't really say who your favorite friends were, but there were certain points in the trip where we started to, I think, really go from one extreme to the other, traveling through, we went to the Grand Canyon and then through Arizona with Mark, who's a God-loving libertarian, and then the next day we were with this huge Mormon family and spending the night at Mormon grandma's house, and then the next day we were with a Navajo family, and then we ended up in New Orleans, and that kind of 6-7 days was really intense and was a whole side of America that I'd never seen before, so that was certainly special for me.
I think you can fall in love with pretty much anyone, given enough time. And so, the people who would, I mean, like, there's this guy named Seth, who we never got in his car. I mean, I got in the back of his truck one time, but at a certain point, we started caravanning, where we would have, you know, one lead car and about 4 or 5 cars in the back, caravanning to wherever we were headed. So me and Seth got really close because we never got in Seth's car. He never really was trying to push to, because
he didn't have room.
Yeah, he didn't have room. Every time we would stop and we would throw our coordinates out, it wasn't like we were waiting for very long. I mean, the first day we waited for about, you know, 20 minutes, and then we started the project. But every time after that, when we would throw our coordinates, people were already standing in front of us. There were, you know, I remember one time there was a crowd of like 400, 500 people trying to pick us up. And so then it becomes a negotiation about who wants to take us the furthest. And Seth was always like a real sweet guy. You know, he never wanted to take the experience away from whoever was next in line. So he wound up just caravanning with us the whole trip, pretty much the second half of the whole trip, last 2 weeks. Me and him got really close. And I think it's, you know, I think that's true of everybody on the trip. It's like the more, and anybody in film or anybody on stage or anybody in art, anybody that you focus on, time helps with falling in love. You know, you can really fall in love pretty much, I think, with anyone if you give somebody enough time. So yeah, me and Seth got close just because he was around all the time.
Yeah. Times were a little bit. I mean, getting in a, for me, getting in the car with someone who has a gun in his, the door of his car is a little bit intimidating for me. And you know, it's a total stranger, and you're getting in a car.
Yeah. And just aesthetically, Rusty was pretty scary. Just in terms of aesthetics, yeah.
There was a guy named Rusty. He's pretty scary looking, dude. Sweetheart, teddy bear, but you know, if he was, I mean, just from across the room, he's not a guy you would at all. So yeah, you know, of course it's scary. Yeah, sure. You don't know where you're headed. You don't know how long you're gonna be there. You don't know if you come back from there. It's pretty scary. Yeah. I think every ride started frosty.
Yeah.
I mean, and on paper, you know, I'm a maniac on paper. You know who's showing up? It could be for real cannibal, for real. Like for me, for instance, when I first met Nastja, I was quite intimidated, you know. So I imagine people felt that as well. Or even Luke is an intellectual, and if you're not like a brilliant dude, you know, some of these conversations are quite intimidating. So yeah, there's fear on all sides, and anybody who gets in your car, you're also hosting a mini party. You don't want anybody to have a shitty party, you know.
Yeah.
You don't want to be the host of a shitty party. And especially, you know, when you get like 3 weeks into it and everybody's been partying for 3 weeks, you don't want to be a person who hosts a shitty party after 3 weeks of cool party. So yeah, there's all that kind of fear and pressure on everyone, and music really helps. Music is a great leveler. Music is a great translator of vibe, you know. And so like, we started like getting these little show us your playlist was a way of like, explain us your life, you know. So after four or five songs, you get a feel for people pretty quick based on music. So
we didn't really have any rules set in stone, but it was more, it became a negotiation, and the really kind of nice thing was that the people who arrived there at the same time realized that, you know, they're all kind of after the same thing, and some people could only get the afternoon off work, so wanted to drive us for a couple of hours, and so other people who'd driven for days were like, okay, so I'll follow you for those 2 hours and then take over then. And they kind of, it kind of worked itself out as we went along. If there were people, somebody wanted to take us an hour away and another person who wanted to take us 1,000 miles, usually the logical thing there is like, we'll let the person take us an hour and then go with the other people.
Any institute, but Finnish institute sounds like crazy. So, like, if you say you're making something and you're like, oh yeah, I'm running with the Finnish institute, it's kind of like cool, man. So, just kind of made it official, felt like official. I'm not much of a filmmaker. I'm an actor, so doing it is helpful. So like monologues and things like that. I mean, when I was coming up, you didn't have YouTube or like a camera or like a platform, you know. So it's much easier now, I think, to get involved, at least from the actor side. The filmmaker side, it's much cheaper to make movies now. Like the film that we made was quite inexpensive. All of our budget went to gas and food and lodging, and sometimes people would pick you up and they had no, because they had been traveling, not just from where they had come, but through states, like four or five states to get to us. So by the time they got to us, the gas budget was gone, you know, and then they're sort of stranded in a place they don't know, and you've befriended them, become friends with them throughout the course, and sort of watching out the back window. So probably shouldn't say this in front of the Finnish Institute, but here we are. A lot of our money went to like paying for other people's gas to keep coming with us. A lot of our money wasn't even on screen. It was just to keep the caravan behind us running so that we could keep our party going. You know, like Simon and Melissa are here, and you know, there's people that we've sort of become friends with throughout the work, and it's created an access channel for closeness that you don't get from like doing a Transformers movie. You know, there's no access, you know, there's no way to shore up the distance. And so like, this is a pretty cool thing, just this practice. And I would say that this project in particular has created the biggest like solid group from all the projects. So, and now they hang out away from us. They go on road trips aside from us. They, you know, they share lives and deaths and births with each other. And, you know, like, when I trip and fall, they're there to help me, you know? So like, it's been pretty cool to have like a message board of real genuine people who don't want nothing from you, who are just like throwing love around. And so it's been a pretty cool after effect of this project, is to have like, you know, 40 people on a message board ready to just throw love at you.
It's on your Twitter, we're nowhere near being finished. So what's the future of the project?
This project specifically?
I assume that's what the tweet meant.
Well, I mean, the tweet actually came from, we
do these strange little preambles before we release them, and everything that's on there, while it is curated, they're all generic definitions from Webster's or Oxford that have the word anywhere in them, and so we've been painting with that palette. It's interesting, like, if you look at, I was talking to Luke about it, it's like the innocuous bullshit that we tweet sometimes, like, you know, winds up getting a bigger following than the film that we made, you know? Like, if you just write, hey, I like eggs, you know, that'll get a whole bunch of, like, retweets and follows, but when you throw the project out that you've actually been promoting, that requires you to go and, like, devote an hour or 40 minutes of your time, that actually gets less of a following. It's kind of weird, because there's this phrase, like, you just said it, Luke, what was it?
About the definitions about
these tweets building up to Take Me Anywhere have been straight from the dictionary, and it's kind of a bit of a running joke that, you know, the idea of an actor who can hold your attention from just reading the dictionary, so that's kind of where those tweets came from. But our tweets on the campaign book come from various sources, and it's one, maybe since we started our practice, it's almost like one continuous kind of, sounds a bit pretentious to say poem, but one continuous piece. And so we kind of use Twitter a little bit as an experimental platform in that respect.
They knew each other from art school. I had plagiarized a comic book, made a movie, and then it went to Cannes, and I was and then I was shooting Fury at the time, and there was a director, David Ayer, who was like, well, you know, go get the narrative. And I was like, what are you talking about? He's like, yeah, just, you know, go take the narrative back, like, retrieve your story. So I started messing around on Twitter, trying to actually apologize. You know, I've been pretty radically transparent my whole life. This was no different. I'm trying to apologize for it, but it came off as insincere. And like, well, how do you sincerely apologize through Twitter? And I started looking for like apologies that worked. So I'm going through like, you know, Justin Bieber to politicians to, and I'm retweeting the ones that I think are effective, like the survivors, you know? So so I started tweeting all these sincere apologies in an insincere kind of play on apologizing. And then started reading the reviews of this action. And so they would bring in a bunch of like art geniuses, right? To review what was going on. And I didn't know anything about art at all. And one of the, there's a bunch of like, oh, this guy's a asshole, or who's this guy I think he is, or blah, blah, blah. And then there's like, there was this one that wasn't like, hey, he's a great person, but there was one who was like, well, I'm not really sure what the intention is, but if it is this intention, that's quite interesting. The person who sent that in, I guess it was like Entertainment Weekly, one of their things, they had asked Luke, and Luke had written that, and then I went to go look up who Luke was, and there was this metamodernist manifesto. I'm not a big reader of manifestos. It was the first manifesto I'd actually ever read. Didn't really understand most of it, but there was a line in there about four or five lines down, said, "Error breeds sense." And I started crying because it felt like putting a key in a door. And it just felt like some kind of freedom. So then I looked up what his email address was and said, "Hey, you know, be nice to meet you." And he didn't believe that it was me. And then he asked me to come to his apartment. And I was filming in Film and Fury, so I was in a tank. And say, "Hey, you know, I could get off this weekend and come back into town." And he's like, "Sure." So I showed up and walked into his apartment. He really likes all his shit in his apartment. He's got like nice everything, you know, not nice everything, but he takes care of everything. And I was like a muddy monster. And so this was our first meetup, which was really, really nice. And like at the time, like I had been seeped in drama. It was really just a nice human interaction. And he seemed like he was like, we were vibing on the same kind of things. And then he's like, "You know, you should look at some of this work." And he brought up Nastja's work and started playing some of her work for me. And he's like, "You know, if me and you are to do anything, you know, this is sort of the world that we need to exist in." And then he gave me Nastja's email, and I emailed Nastja, said, "Hey, hi, I met your friend Luke, and we're thinking about doing this." And she wrote back, and then me and her started vibing, and that's sort of how we all met, based off like fan letters and desperation.
We always had the film in mind when we were doing the project, but I think what we didn't want to happen was for us to be out there making a documentary, or for the camera, or for us filming it to be apart from what we were filming. So that's why we ended up using the camera we did, which has this cool little kind of pistol grip, and you can kind of pass it around, and we had people who were taking part. You know, we were handing them the cameras, and that kind of that broke the ice, and it became, oh, we're making like a home movie, and let's all be in it, and so that meant that what the film is quite fragmented, and gives you kind of a glimpse into what happened. I don't think you can ever really capture the experience of being there or kind of forensically analyze it, and that's not what the film is. But yeah, to give a feeling of what that is, but to not be detrimental in any way to the performance of the month. And I think it ended up working out really well.
Filming almost all the time, so we had like hours and hours and hours of material, so I think it was super difficult to edit it down. But then I guess it was like we tried to give the feeling of the trip or feeling of the performance rather than like trying to get everything in. And the music is a massive part of it, so we wanted to keep that in. And I think through music you kind of get the feeling of what happened.
One thing you don't get is the deep frustration between the three of us. You know, I mean, there's mad love here, but you know, if you locked yourself in a car for a month with anybody you love, after a while, it's just like, shut up. Just shut up. I've heard that story, you know, I don't want to stop there. It's just, you smell like charcoal, it's whatever. It just starts to just eat away at you. And we didn't want to put that in the movie because we didn't really film that. When that feeling would pop up, the camera would sort of drop down, and you know, we just didn't have much material about that. You know, we also, like, we all three went home with the footage and sort of crafted our own cuts. Mine was much darker, much darker. And so, you know, there's like a, you know, there's three people here, and not to mention the 40 people online, so who also had agency and were part of crafting this. So it's hard to take yourself out of your own opinion of what you've just gone through and try to take other people's opinions on. And so I guess the thing that doesn't wind up on film is the actual crafting of the film and like the editing process and the emails that fly between all three of us and, you know, things like that. You don't get that in the film. A lot of the redemption came from the drivers. We'd get in and they would cheerlead our friendship and they would cheerlead the project. And you know, 3 weeks in, you're just like, you're about to bang your head into a wall. You're really just struggling. I mean, to the point of like, you know, that purr right before you're about to cry in your voice, where you're just like, that purr is there, and you're like, hey, you know, like broken people. That's real, you know. So we got a lot of like love from the drivers. There'd be times where like I couldn't talk, you know, or Luke couldn't talk, or Nastja didn't want to talk, and you know, that person would take the time throughout the trip or the course where and sort of meet us on an individual level. You know, you build a friendship, and these people carry you. You know, that's what I felt.
Every new morning was a kind of reset, and you're posting the coordinates out, and then a stranger is going to come, and they don't know what's gone before. They're not in the group yet. You know, you're telling the people who've been added in the group what's going on, maybe, but then you've got to kind of reset. And sometimes that was really hard, yeah. But it was also offered that hope to, you know, start fresh all the time. And I think if we didn't have that, we probably would have ended up killing each other.
Yeah, I think we were trying to support each other. So if someone needed to be like quiet or annoyed, we were just trying to either like make conversation or like, you know, be with the driver when like some of us couldn't. It took a lot of energy just like to get to know two people and like just be with them, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, we went with Luke's cut because it was the most like neutral between the two. With like, you know, certain things from each cut. But we all went home and sort of got on iMovie and just, you know, when you have to bring in a specialist, it makes it less accessible. And we kind of like seeing the human DIY mistakes. It's nice to feel like, oh, you know, sitting at home, like, oh, I could do that too. So we didn't bring in an editor. We kind of learned on the fly. I had edited a couple like music videos and things like that. They had both made videos together, so we had enough like real base level knowledge about it to watch a tutorial and get into it. But did that answer?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. If I was given like the last script before I die, kind of thing, I feel like that every time. It's always the first and last time. I'm pretty neurotic, you know. I always think I'm about to die. But especially when I'm going to work, because you know, I have not been a person who's thought a lot about eulogy virtues throughout my life. I've been like a careerist. So you know, the most important thing to me until quite recently has been like the movies, more than my mother or my wife or my friends or anything. It's been my everything, which is like building a house on quicksand. So to answer your question, it always feels like the last time. And that's like a blessing in a way. It keeps you away from complacency. In terms of like what I would like to do, I'm an actor, you know, I'm an exhibitionist, you know. I think we were also blessed with the fact that like we sort of made this in a pre-Trump America. And I think after Trump, everything got really extreme. In terms of the division that Nas is talking about abortion and things like that, it started getting really extreme. So I think that's the main difference in the works, other than the fact that, you know, they were after different things also. And also the same things also. Totally different projects, but also back to the thing about time, you know, he will not divide us. You would show up, and it was a full-fledged block party by the time you showed up. So you have less time to be able to open up, and it's less intimate because you know, we were in a car that wasn't being live streamed. The interaction inside wasn't being live streamed, so there was less of a performance. You know, you put somebody in front of a camera, you're going to get their representative. You're not going to get them. So and He Will Not Divide Us, you had a lot of people who had representatives show up for them. It wasn't necessarily them. It was people who were after something. Whereas with this, you had less representatives show up and more time to get to like the meaty bit. So I mean, for me, those are the big differences.
He Will Not Divide Us was a definite response to, you know, the kind of dire situation in America and in Europe and a lot of places in the world at the moment, becoming more polarized through I think, you know, social media has a role to play in that, in keeping people in their bubbles and people becoming more polarized and Take Me Anywhere kind of bridged that, because there were people, you know, coming from different bubbles but kind of connecting through this work. But He Will Not Divide Us is definitely taking a stand against something, against division. So it's kind of almost the flip side to that, and kind of asserting and standing up for something.